Oke, sebelumnya kita doa dulu sebelum belajar yuk. Robbi, Zidni, Ilman, Warzukni, Fahman. Kita mau lanjutin baca cerita tentang surat Al-Masad. Kan surat yang kalian pasti semua udah hafal. I know, you already memorized this surah. This is about all the bad things that Abu Lahab and his wife did. Because all that the bad thing both of them did, then Allah reveal suratul Masad. Kemarin masih ada yang ingat ya? Do you remember what kind of the bad thing they did for Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? You still remember? Ada yang ingat nggak? Apa aja yang udah dilakukan sama Abu Lahab and his wife. Yuk kita ulang sedikit yuk. Kita baca lagi ulang. What kind of the bad deed they do until Allah reveal this surah. Okay. First, the bad thing that Abu Lahab did.
You shut down.
They're really, really bad. Some people, they just not nice, but they're not bad. They just like rude. But these people is really bad people. Okay. First, what they did is Abu Lahab, two son, Utbah and Utaybah were married to two of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam daughter, Kulsum and Ruqayyah. But when Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam started teaching Islam, he ordered his two sons to divorce their wife. And they did. Okay, that the first bad thing. And then second thing is Abu Lahab would follow Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam wherever he went and would tell people not to listen to him. And then when Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam first son Abdullah died, Abu Lahab went out celebrating. So when somebody's son die, we have to have empathy. We need to also feel sad for them, but not Abu Lahab. He's so happy, he even went out celebrate. You see, the Quraysh thought the more sons you had, the better. With Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam only son at that time, Abu Lahab thought no one would listen to Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam anymore, but he's wrong. Now, let's see what Abu Lahab's wife, Jamil, did. What did Jamil do that was so bad? Anybody remember what did Jamil do? Okay, if you don't remember, let's read again. Once when Rasulullah ﷺ was sick and could not get up at night to pray for 2 or 3 days, Jamil came to him and said, "It looks like your shaitan has left you." She was trying to say that the Quran was from shaitan and not Allah. When Jamil heard about Suratul Masad, she got so angry. She could not stand it. She rushed from her house, grabbed a stone, and hid it for the Ka'bah to attack Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Rasulullah saw her coming, but he recited a verse from the Quran, and Allah made it that Jamil could not see him. So even though Rasulullah right in front of Jamil, she couldn't see Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam at all. She stormed off still burning with desire for revenge. So she couldn't find Rasulullah. At night, Jamil would sneak over to Rasulullah's house and place thorny branches at the front door, hoping that when he came out in the morning, he would step on them and get hurt. So that's another bad thing. Because of all these things that Abu Lahab and his wife did, Allah revealed Suratul Masad. Somebody put a crown on my head. Suratul Masad is a message for Abu Lahab and Jamil, and for anyone who hate Islam like they did. Allah did not like what Abu Lahab and his wife were doing. So he sent them a special message in Suratul Masad, but they did not like what the message said. Now let's learn what Allah said to Abu Lahab and Jamil in Suratul Masad. Okay, let's recite this together. May the hands of Abu Lahab be ruined, and ruined is he. Okay, let's recite together. A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. You can open your microphone so we can recite. Okay. Di surat together. Oops. Tabbat yada Abi Lahab wa tab. What is yada mean? This is, you see the word in a box. Yada. Remember this one of the four words that we learned last
week.
Yeah, hand. So Allah wants to make Abu Lahab hand get ruined because he not using his hand for the good thing. He using his hand for doing a bad thing. Yeah. So if Allah already give you hands, Allah already give you eyes, mouth, everything, you need to do it for the good things. What the good things can you do with your hand?
Like reading Quran.
Reading Quran, yeah, you can hold. You can hold the Quran with your hand. And then what else? Good thing.
Make food for your sister.
Ah, sorry.
Draw something good.
Yeah, draw something good.
Mm-hmm.
What else? Reading Quran, drawing something good. What the other
good? Do thing? Not fight.
Good thing.
Helping someone.
Don't you
helping someone? Yeah, like maybe your mommy comes from the grocery store, and she brings a lot of plastic bags, and you can take one of it and help. That means you helping your somebody with your hand. What else? Reading Quran, drawing like something good.
Helping someone bringing antique stuff.
Yeah, bringing some, helping by bringing something. What else you can do with your hand? There's so many things we can do with our hand.
Like, write a word.
Yeah, like write. Maybe if somebody's sick, you can write a letter, so you can send. Like I remember one time, Anira sent a letter to her neighbors upstairs. Right? Remember that? Mm-hmm. When they receive the letter, they're happy, and you make people happy. That's also a good thing. Now, what is the bad thing you can do with your hand?
Fight with people.
Fight with people. What else?
Not helping someone doing the groceries bag.
Not helping someone. What else? What is the bad thing you can do?
Throwing rock on cat.
Yeah, throwing rock on a cat.
Throwing a rock to someone's head.
Yeah, throwing a rock, things like that. Or slam the door when you get angry. You slam the door really hard until it almost break. Or you broke your, you throw something, you broke toys. And you get mad, also not a good thing to do. Okay, next. Abu Lahab had said, when he heard this first, and then Abu Lahab said, may you be destroyed, when Rasulullah called the people to listen to the message of Islam on Mount Safa. Allah had said before to Rasulullah, may you be destroyed. Okay. So and then Allah reply.
Apa?
Allah reply by saying. What is Allah replies, Anira? Allah reply by said. Wait, sorry. Why it happened this? I need to rotate. Where's the rotation? Where is the rotation? Couldn't find the rotation.
Where is the book?
I think I need to close this first. And then open it again. The book. Page down.
This meaning is so loud.
Yeah.
Yeah, what was it?
Okay. Okay, Anira, what is Allah said? To Abu Lahab.
May you be destroyed.
Yeah, Abu Lahab said to Rasulullah, may you be destroyed. But then Allah replied by saying,
when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called the people to listen to the message of Islam at Mount Safa.
And then what Allah said to Abu Lahab?
I can only say so Allah said. I can't see anything else.
Oh, you can't see anything else? Okay, yeah. Let's... Now, can you see?
Abu Lahab will be destroyed.
Yeah, Abu Lahab said Rasulullah will be destroyed, but no, Allah said no, it's not Rasulullah, but Abu Lahab will be destroyed. Okay, now the second ayah is ma aghna anhu maluhu wa ma kasab. Let's recite it together.
Wama kasab
ma aghna
maluhu wama kasab.
Okay, what is this ayah tell us about? The first ayah tell us that Allah will destroy Abu Lahab. And then the second ayah, then Abu Lahab had said also, even if what my nephew say is true, I will ransom myself or save myself from the painful torment on the day of judgment with my wealth and my children. He thought he would go to Jannah no matter what. So Abu Lahab said he will go to Jannah because he's so rich and has a lot of children. And then what is Allah said? What is Allah reply? Can you read this? So Allah said,
"Me, your money and children will not help you.
Yeah, money and children will not help you. Even though you have a lot of money, you have a lot of children. If you are a bad people, you will not go to Jannah." Especially if you're not believe in Allah. If you're not Muslim, even though you are very rich, you have plenty of money, and you have a lot of children, none of that can help you to go to Jannah.
You have to help poor people. Assalamualaikum, saudara.
Waalaikumsalam, Nafa. How are you?
Alhamdulillah, thank you.
Assalamualaikum so for Sabita, Konita, and Salim. Welcome. So what Abu Lahab thought is different from reality. He said, oh, Rasulullah will destroy. And then Allah replied, no, you are being destroyed. And then he said, oh, I'm not going to hell. I'm going to Jannah because I'm rich and a lot of kids. And then Allah replied, no matter how much money you have or how many kids you have, you will not go to Jannah. And then if Abu Lahab's not going to Jannah, and where he's going then? Where he's ended?
Hell.
Yeah. Here's the answer. In another surah, Allah told us, sayasla naran dhata lahab. Let's recite this together.
Sayasla naran dhata lahab.
Okay, you see the box, the words in the box, naran. What is the meaning?
Fire.
Yada is hand, fire. Naran is fire. And then he will enter to burn in a fire or a blazing flame. So he will go to enter the fire. He will not go to Jannah, but enter the fire. Sayasla narang. And then, ayah number 4. Do you know what is the ayah number 4? Yeah. Okay, and then Abu Lahab, before Abu Lahab had said, if I were to accept your religion, what would I get? Rasulullah said, you would get what the other believer would get. Abu Lahab got angry and said, is there no special reward for me? So Abu Lahab thinks that he's so big, he's so special, he's an important person. So he wants get a reward more than other people. When Rasulullah said he will get what other people get, and he's so angry, why there is no special reward for me? Rasulullah asked, what else do you want? What do you think Abu Lahab want? What do you think the answer when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked, what else do you want?
Become rich.
Yeah, that made Abu Lahab burn with anger because he thought he should get a special reward better than everyone else. And then Allah replied by saying, what is Allah said?
Will be burned in
Jahannam.
Yeah, Abu Lahab won't get any special reward, but instead he will be burned in Jahannam.
Yes, because he did not help anybody or read Quran or Salah. Or not, help any poor people.
But what that he did? Yeah, he did not do that thing, but what is Abu Lahab did?
I don't know.
He did a lot of bad things to Rasulullah, like tell everybody, don't listen to Rasulullah. And the wife also wants to hurt Rasulullah by throwing like dirty branches, yeah, a rock.
Poop.
So Abu Lahab will not get special reward, but instead he will go to Jahannam. Okay, this is the fourth ayah. Let's recite together. wa mura'atuhu hammalatal hatab. Okay, you see the circle box here?
The square.
The square box. Okay, what is the meaning of al hatab?
Firewood.
Okay, and then Allah said in this surah, and his wife as well, the carrier of firewood. Hamalah mean the carrier, al-hattab mean firewood. Let's see the explanation of this ayah. Wa mura'atuhu hammalatal hatab. Okay, now it's turn to Ummu Jamil now. Before we already talk about what Abu Lahab said, now what Ummu Jamil had said. He, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, criticized our father and his religion is our scorn. She thought that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not treating her family with respect and honor. They deserve due to their position as leaders in Makkah society. So they think they are respected people. And he got angry when Rasulullah criticized their family. So what Allah said for the replying of Jamil word, so Allah said, what Allah said?
Is Abu Lahab's wife will be a wood carrier in Jahannam.
Who is Abu Lahab's wife? Who is her name?
Jamil.
So Jamil will also going to enter Jahannam. Okay, what's next? Jamil, can somebody erase this red?
That's not me.
Tantada, because you're the one sharing screen, you can erase it too. You can erase whatever is on the screen.
Really? Okay,
yeah.
Let's see.
Yes.
Can erase. Only the person that drawed it can erase.
Yeah, I think only the person who drew can erase
this. But for you, you can erase all of ours.
Okay. Let me check.
Okay.
How can I erase this?
Just go to annotate. Annotate and then clear all.
Okay, annotate and then I need to clear this. Okay, I have eraser here. See, I can't do that. I think only the person. Okay, I try to clear all drawing. Okay, yeah, done. Thank you, Anira.
Welcome.
Jamil was a wealthy woman in this life with many servants and slaves. Now Allah told her that in the next life, she would be a slave herself, carrying heavy loads of wood over and over again to add to the fire that will burn Abu Lahab. Oh, it's really cannot imagine. So years before, is a wealthy woman, she's respected, honored woman, and then in the Jahannam, she will be slave carrying a load of wood for
fire.
Yeah, for fire that will burn her husband, Abu Lahab. Let's see next. Then we need to close this first. You see the fire, this is the hot top that Jamil will bring to burn her husband. Now the last.
Oh no.
Okay, let's recite the fifth ayat. Okay, do you see the rectangle words, the words inside the rectangle? Hablum. What is the meaning? Do you remember? Hubble.
Fire? Fire?
It's, no, fire is not. It's something long. And you can't. Yeah, rope. Rope.
Huh? Oh, rope.
Yeah, rope. Okay.
I thought
it was around her neck is a rope of twisted fiber. So Jamil carrying heavy load of firewood, and also in her neck is a rope of twisted fiber. CGDH. So in her neck, there are a rope min masat. Jamil had said, Jamil had said, indeed, the Quraysh know that I am the daughter of their leader. She was so proud of herself, her wealth, her beauty, and her position in Makkah. She thought she was the best woman, but Allah did not think so. So, Allah said, what did Allah say?
Around her neck will be a rope of fiber.
Her Jamil's neck will
be a rope of palm fiber.
A rope of hand
fiber. So usually you see all the princess what they wear in their neck.
Gold.
Necklace with from like a pearl or diamond. That means you are a very rich woman, very wealthy, and in a high position. But to show that Jamil no longer wealthy and no longer like a kind of princess thing, Allah put not a necklace but put a rope in her neck. That to show it's not a respected woman anymore.
Or like a golden chief, like your bed.
Yeah. In the next life, Allah is informing her that around her beautiful neck will be something very different than the glittering jewels she used to. It will be a rope like the one used for tying animals. So you see, a dog usually have a collar, right? And Jamil is like a tying animals. It will be made of the roughest palm fiber, twisted, cutting her skin. A severe punishment from Allah. No one will envy her then. So usually she wore this in dunya, but now in Jahannam, she will wear this thing, a robe. Death of Abu Lahab. Now you may think that Allah was going to wait until Yawmul Qiyamah to punish Abu Lahab, but he didn't. Allah punished Abu Lahab in this life and will punish him in the next life as well. Here is what happened to Abu Lahab. Must be a very bad thing happened to Abu Lahab. After the battle of Badar, Abu Lahab spoke to Abu Sufyan or Jamil's brother to see what had happened during the battle. When he heard, I think I missed some part. When he heard that Muslim had won and that the Quraysh had run away, he was angrier than ever. There was a slave named Abu Rafi sitting nearby who overheard the good news. This slave was a Muslim, but no one knew he had accepted Islam. When Abu Lahab saw that Abu Rafi was happy about the victory of Muslim, He Abu Lahab jumped up and started beating him, beating the slave. He's a really bad person. Fadil's Abu Lahab's sister-in-law, who was secretly a Muslim too, saw Abu Lahab beating Abu Rafi. And he decided to stop him. He grabbed a heavy stick and hit Abu Lahab over the head as hard as he could. Abu Lahab could not hit her back because she was the wife of his brother. So he just went home with a huge cut on his head. But this was no ordinary cut. The cat got infected with a terrible disease. So that spread all over his body. He was in unbearable pain. So Abu Lahab got infected from the cat. And the pus coming out from his wound gave off a hideous smell. No one envied him now. His well and his son could not save him. Even his wife, who had assisted him in his evil deeds, left him to suffer alone. So nobody will help. So no matter how much money he had, no matter how many kids he have, nobody will help. After 7 days, he finally died. Now his family had to get rid of his body. But no one dared to come near him for fear that they would get some disease. They left him in his house for a few days. Well, they tried to figure out what to do. Finally, his son paid men to take his body out of the house and cover it with stones on a hill outside of Makkah. And that was the end of Abu Lahab. So he's just died slowly alone, and nobody would not go near him because he's so smelly from the wound. So they just throw him away, his own son, throw him away. So his sons could not help, but the son is the one who threw him away. And like, so what is Suratul Masad all about? Suratul Masad is all about how Abu Lahab and his wife, Jamil, will be punished for fighting against Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Islam. Suratul Masad teach us 5 good lessons. Let's learn what they are. The first good lesson that Suratul Masad teach us is the most important thing. They need to make it smaller so you can see whole page. I think somebody's play with the mouse. Can you control? Yeah, could you please control until we can see? Thank you. The first good lesson that Suratul Masad teach us, the most important thing in this life is for Allah to be happy with you. So what is the first lesson? It's how you can make Allah happy with you. That's the first important thing. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, need to make it bigger, wanted his family to be happy with him, but he wanted Allah to be happy him even more. This is why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did what Allah told him to do. Even though some of his family members like Abu Lahab and Jamil did not like it. The same is true for us. Maybe we have family members who are non-Muslim or Muslim family members who are not doing the things they should do. It is our job to teach them about Allah and what Allah wants us to do, even if they don't like it or get angry with us. In the end, it's most important for Allah to be happy with us than for our family to be happy with us. The second good lesson that Suratul Masad teach us is Allah protect the Muslim. Abu Lahab and Jamil tried everything they could think for harm of Rasulullah SAW. They thought they would never be punished for what they did, but Allah punished them in this life and will punish them in the next life too. This teach us that no matter what people may do to the Muslim, because we believe in Allah, in the end, we all have to go back to Allah and answer for what we did. The third good lesson that Suratul Masah teach us is about what? The third lesson.
Never help someone in doing something bad.
Yeah, never help someone in doing something bad. Like what? For example. Never help your friend cheated. That, for example. Because cheat is a bad thing, so you should never help your friends cheat. Jamil helped her husband. Can somebody read back? Let me control the mouse, okay?
Only you can control the mouse.
I think somebody's control the mouse right now because I did not touch anything. Let's go back. Okay, the third one's never help your friend or anybody's doing a bad thing. Okay. We should not do what Jamil did by helping someone do something wrong, or we will share in their punishment too. So what Jamil did, just helping his husband make a bad thing for Rasulullah. But because he's helping someone to do a bad thing, he also got a punishment. A Muslim should only help other people to do things that are good and that which Allah likes. Like Allah tells us in the Quran, help not one another in sin and transgression. Fear Allah, for Allah is strict on punishment. So never help anyone do the bad thing. The fourth good lesson that Suratul Masad teach us is, what is the fourth? Yeah, da'wah is a hard work. It was not easy for Rasulullah to go on Mount Safa and tell his people about Islam, but he had to do it. For us as Muslims, we have to teach others about Islam too. This work called da'wah is not just for Muslims who live in non-Muslim country. Muslims even need to do da'wah in Muslim countries where many of the people do not do the things that they are supposed to do, like making shahada 5 times a day or fasting in Ramadan. So this is da'wah. Da'wah is like help somebody else doing a good thing. Like you can help your friends not cheat, like teach them how to do the math problem. That's a da'wah. And you can tell your non-Muslim friend about fasting, about praying, that's also da'wah. It's hard, but we can do it. Every Muslim has a job to do, just like Rasulullah SAW did. And we have to try to be as brave as he was, inshallah. The fifth lesson is?
Always be patient and have good manners.
Yeah, I know it's very hard. And we cannot always be patient, but if you really got angry, if you cannot control your anger, just stay away from your family and you can do a good thing by yourself, like writing, drawing. At least you're not, like I told you before, don't be too angry. So you can be angry, but you need to make it less angry. Because I know it's very hard to always be patient and always have good manner. But we can try as much as we can to always be patient and have good manners. If we cannot be patient, what the thing can we do? Like Sabita, if you cannot be patient at that time, what you can do?
Entertain yourself.
Entertain yourself. What else? For me, if I am so angry with my kids, I will go to another room and stay in that room. And then take a deep breath. And I say to myself, it's an emergency. I don't know if it's bad. I can control myself. Because when we are not patient, we cannot have good manner without patience. Even though Abu Lahab and Jamil were very cruel to Rasulullah, he never complained or treated them badly in return. As Muslims, always have a good manners and treat people fairly, even if they have not been treated well. Okay, I think that's for today. We finished Suratul Masa Tafsir with the five good lessons. What is the five good lessons that you remember?
Tante Dara?
Yes?
Your voice was not clear before. Voice was not clear before.
Yeah, it sounded like a robot.
Like, rah, rah,
I think that's for the internet. Okay, so we finished Suratul Masa Tafsir. So what is the five good lessons you remember from the surah?
Tante Dara, the noise again.
Okay, yeah. What is five? It's like a, what is like a sheep sound? What is five good lessons?
No, like a robot.
Five lessons you learn from this surah.
Always
you should use your hand for good things.
Use your hand for good things.
Come on, they're really crazy.
Don't help people do bad stuff.
Yeah, don't help people.
And if someone is not nice to you, you shouldn't be not nice to them.
Yeah. Even though your friend is not nice to you, doesn't mean you need to be bad, to treat them bad. Then what else?
Don't help people doing the bad thing.
Be good.
Don't help people. Be good.
I said be good.
Be good, yeah. And also the one thing is that no matter what, Allah will help who?
Muslim.
Yeah, that's the five things we learned from Suratul Masad. So next week we can start for another surah. Not next week. I think on Wednesday. So I will see you on Wednesday, inshallah. On Wednesday we will have like a quiz about the Masad, and then we learn new surah.
Yes.
So see you on Wednesday, inshallah. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alamin, Astaghfirullahaladzim, Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika, Asyadu ala ilaha, Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilai. Okay, Assalamualaikum. Have a nice day. Enjoy your holiday.
Assalamualaikum,
Tante
Dara.
Bye.
Bye. Sama-sama.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Terima kasih, Tante Dara. Assalamualaikum. Dita Isi pamit.
Ya, sama-sama. Tante pamit juga. Oke, Tante akan end meeting for all.